Ravan picks up Kailash. Ravan, king of Rakshas, was a great devotee of Shiva. Every day, he would travel from Lanka, his island kingdom, which is in the south, to Mount Kailash in the north, and pay his respects to Shiva in person. But as time passed, Ravan found it increasingly difficult to make these daily trips to the north.
This is very tiring. Though I love the Lord and happy to see him every day, it would be better if I have the Lord closer to me.
He decided to uproot Mount Kailash and bring it to the south for his convenience. Ravan was gifted with the strength of 100 gods. With his bare hands, he proceeded to lift Mount Kailash. The mountain shook and the snow tumbled down. Parvati was irritated by Ravan's behavior. "Lord, your devotee is taking his devotion too far. I'm not able to tolerate this. And the whole Kailash is trembling. Please do something to stop this." So was Shiva.
"I am aware of his good intentions behind this action. Still, he needs to be taught a lesson."
He put the mountain back in its place, trapping Ravana, king beneath it. Ravan cried out in pain.
"Lord, I'm not able to withhold this. It's paining. Please come to my rescue."
But Shiva refused to let him go. To pacify the angry god, Ravan began composing hymns in Shiva's honor. The beauty of these hymns melted Shiva's heart.
"Ravan, I am appeased by your hymns of praise. Now you are free to go."
And he let the demon king go with his blessings. Arjun fights Shiva. Arjun, the proud prince of Hastinapur, wanted the great Pashupata missile from Shiva. He installed a linga in the middle of a jungle and began worshipping it with bell leaves. One day, Arjun's penance was disturbed by a wild boar.
"This boar is disturbing my penance. Let me kill this beast."
Irritated, he raised his bow and shot it dead. At exactly the same time, another arrow hit the boar. It belonged to a tribal warrior, a Kirata.
"Why did you waste your arrow after I killed it?"
"It is my arrow that killed the boar."
Both claimed the boar as their trophy.
"Let's settle this matter by the laws of the jungle. Let us fight for it."
So the prince and the tribal fought, first with weapons, then with bare hands. Arjun discovered that this opponent was much stronger than him.
"I can't believe this. I am not able to defeat this tribal warrior."
"Do you give in?"
Arjun, who had never lost a fight in his life, couldn't bear this humiliation. With tears in his eyes, he looked at the Shivalinga and said,
"My lord, please help me."
Suddenly, the tribal let Arjun go. When Arjun swung around, he found, to his great surprise, bell leaves on the head of the Kirata, the same ones he had placed on the linga.
"Oh Lord, please forgive my sins. I am really ashamed of entering into a combat with you." "You have not sinned. It is I who enacted a play to test your devotion. Ask for any boon, and it will be granted."
Shiva blessed Arjun and gave him the weapon he wanted. Sharaba the dragon. The demon Hiranyakashyap could be killed by neither man nor beast, neither inside a house nor outside, neither in the day or at night. Vishnu took the form of Narasimha, a creature that was part of man and part lion. He attacked Hiranyakashyap at twilight, ripped out his heart on the threshold of his house and drank his blood. The conditions of death were met and the demon was destroyed.
"That is the end of Hiranyakashyap."
Contaminated by the demon's blood, Vishnu became ferocious and he started attacking innocent people.
"Help us, O Lord! Help us!
Help me to get rid of this form! I can no longer control it!
I have to save the soul of Vishnu."
So Shiva, in the form of a Sharaba, a dragon with 8 legs that was part bird, part serpent, part lion, caught hold of Narasimha and flayed it alive, allowing Vishnu's spirit to escape.
Thank you, Lord.
Daksha curses the moon. Once, Shiva saved the moon. By doing so, he incurred Daksha's wrath. Chandra, the moon god, had married 27 of Daksha's daughters, the Nakshatras, but he preferred only one of them, the charming Rohini.
You are the most charming one.
He ignored the rest, angering Daksha, who cursed him.
May your radiant body, of which you're so proud, wither away and disappear.
As the curse took effect, Chandra became weak and dim. With each passing day, his luster waned. Terrified, he went to the gods seeking a cure, but there was none forthcoming. Vishnu suggested,
go to Shiva. He is Somnath, keeper of the sacred plant Soma that might cure you.
Sure enough, Vaidyanath, the supreme physician, helped restore his luster. But in time, Daksha's accursed disease returned, once again gnawing into Chandra's flesh. The moon god ran to Shiva for help and again sought the magical Soma.
Oh Vaidyanath, the disease is back. I need some Soma leaves to cure my dreaded curse.
You are always welcome to have them as much as you want.
Even this cure was followed by a relapse. This went on for some time. Curse followed by cure followed by curse. Chandra's terrible melody wouldn't go away. Finally, Shiva said,
come and stay within the locks of my hair. Here, you will find all the Soma you need. Each time the disease troubles you, you can rejuvenate yourself with my grace.
Shiva's blessing went against Daksha's curse. While Daksha caused the moon to wane, Shiva, by placing the moon on his head, helped it to wax again. Shiva, the savior of moon, came to be known as Chandrasekhara. Thanks to him, moonlight came to be filled with the magic of Soma, and the moon came to be known as Soma.
Lord Vishnu worships Lord Shiva. Once irritated by the wickedness committed by demons, the gods approached Lord Vishnu and prayed.
Oh Lord, please save us from the wickedness of the demons. You are our true savior.
O gods, it is not I, but Lord Shiva who is the savior of us all. Please don't worry. I shall worship Lord Shiva and pray to bring an end to your plight.
Lord Vishnu began worshipping Lord Shiva with great devotion. He used to utter 1,000 names of Lord Shiva, and with each name he would offer one lotus flower, and thus his worship continued for 1,000 years undisturbed. One day, Lord Shiva wished to test the sincerity of Lord Vishnu in his devotion. Like other days, that day also, Lord Vishnu brought 1,000 lotus flowers to offer in worship to Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva hid one of the lotus flowers somewhere. Lord Vishnu was not aware of this, but when he found one flower less, he began searching every corner of the earth for the lost flower. Since it was a game played by Lord Shiva, there was no chance of Lord Vishnu could have traced it. Ultimately, having no alternative, Lord Vishnu gouged out one of his eyes, which were considered as beautiful as lotus flower, and offered it to Lord Shiva as an offering. Seeing such a great sacrifice made by Lord Vishnu, Lord Shiva became extremely pleased and immediately appeared to him.
Vishnu, I am very happy with you. Ask for any boon and it shall be granted. There isn't anything that I cannot give you.
Oh Lord, I did not say anything. You are omniscient. Still, if you wish, it is I who must tell you. Let me tell you, the whole world is suffering. At the hand of the demons, religion has lost its identity. So it is necessary to destroy the demon clan in order to safeguard the interest of religion and the sages. My own weapons are incapable of annihilating them. And this precisely is the reason why I have come in your shelter.
Lord Shiva immediately gave away his Sudarshana Chakra, a disc-like divine weapon, to Lord Vishnu.
This weapon will help you restore peace and destroy evil.
And it was with this chakra that Lord Vishnu succeeded in annihilating the demon clan and freeing the world from atrocities of the demons.
Kirtimukha's obedience. Once angered by the Yakshas' insulting nature, Shiva created a monster to eat him alive.
Lord, please forgive me. Have mercy on me. You're the omniscient. I plead you to let me live.
Shiva's, whose temper falls faster than it rises, lets him go.
As you have asked for forgiveness, I am letting you go.
But what about me?
Asked the monster who had just been created.
I was created to eat the Yaksha. What will I eat now? I'm still hungry, Lord.
Eat yourself,
said Shiva casually. The monster took Shiva's words seriously and began eating himself. He ate his legs, his trunk, his heart, his stomach. He ate every part of his body and was left with only his head. Shiva was amazed at the monster's obedience. He said,
I am pleased with you. Henceforth, you will be known as Kirtimukha, face of glory. Your face will be seen on every arch located even above the gods.
So it is that on every arch, in every temple and shrine, on the arches one finds the terrible yet blessed face of Shiva's Gana, Kirtimukha. It is a perfect symbol of life, feeding on itself for survival. Markandeya's 16th birthday. Markandeya was destined to die at the tender age of 16. Reconciled to his terrible fate, he decided to spend the last hours of his life praying to Shiva.
Let me praise and live in the shadow of my Lord.
Time passes quickly. Before he knew it, Yama, the god of death, stood before him ready to cast his dreaded noose.
Oh, Markandeya, it's now time for you to leave this world. I have come to take your life.
Will you please wait until I complete my prayers to my Lord?
He begged. Yama laughed.
Death waits for no one, young man.
So saying, he cast his noose and began dragging Markandeya's life out of his body. Markandeya suddenly realized that death meant separation from his Lord. He embraced the linga and held on tight.
Oh my Lord, help me! I don't want to leave you!
He cried. Markandeya's cry moved Shiva to come out of the linga and stopped Yama.
Stop this at once, Yama.
But this is his destiny. He must die when he completes the 16th year of his life.
In that case, Markandeya will never complete the 16th year of his life. He will remain a boy of 15 until the day he chooses to die.
Markandeya, saved from the jaws of death, wept tears of joy. Draupadi's five husbands. Draupadi, princess of Panchala, wanted the perfect husband. So she prayed to Shiva.
Yes, my daughter, your prayers have pleased me and you will be granted whatever you ask.
I want an husband who is noble, she asked.
So be it,
he said. I want an husband who is strong, she asked.
So be it,
he said. I want an husband who is skilled, she asked.
So be it,
he said. I want an husband who is handsome, she asked.
So be it,
he said. I want a husband who is wise, she asked.
So be it,
he said. Draupadi was pleased, unaware that Shiva in his divine innocence had given her not one but five husbands, the Pandavas, Yudhishthira the noble, Bhima the strong, Partha the skilled, Nakula the handsome and Sahadeva the wise. Bhasmaka's touch. Shiva once gave a demon called Bhasmaka the power to kill any creature by his mere touch.
I grant you a boon that any creature you touch will die immediately.
Thank you, my lord, for granting me this boon. But I doubt if it will work.
Then go ahead and test it on any creature you like.
Lord, let me just touch you and see if this really works.
The demon decided to test this power on Shiva himself. He moved his hands menacingly towards Shiva. Shiva, shaken, got up and ran. The whole cosmos witnessed the spectacle, Shiva being chased by Bhasmaka. They would not have laughed had they not realized the seriousness of the situation.
Shiva's destruction would lead to cosmic annihilation. Help me!
I will,
promised the cosmic savior. Taking the form of ravishing damsel Mohini, Vishnu appeared before Bhasmaka. Looking at her, the demon forgot about Shiva.
May I embrace you?
Only if you dance with me. Mohini started to dance and the Bhasmaka imitated all her movements. When she put her left foot forward, he did the same. Then she placed her right hand on her navel, he did the same. Finally, when she placed her hands on top of her head, he did the same. With that, Bhasmaka's own body burst into flames. Vishnu had saved Shiva's life. For that, Shiva was most grateful. Brahma's fifth head. Shiva took a look at the world created by Brahma. It was terrible. He saw pain and suffering, death and disease. He saw frustration, unhappiness and misery. He saw cruelty and had an occasional glimpses of the pleasure that cheated all creatures into going through one life before moving on to the next.
Oh, how painful is the creation!
Shiva wept, and from his tears came the Rudraksha beads.
What have you done, Brahma? You haven't created a world, you have created a tantalizing mirage, Maya, that ensnares man into an eternity of aspiration and frustration.
Do not question my creation.
Brahma was in no mood to listen. Instead, he sprouted four heads to survey all sides of his creation. He was quite proud of it. So proud, in fact, that he popped her fifth head to accommodate his pride. The sight of an uncaring creator, the pompous five-headed Brahma, angered Shiva. He became Bhairava, the furious one. With his sharp claws, he attacked Brahma.
How dare you attack me? For this act of disrespect, you will never be invited to any sacrifice or any portion of the sacred offerings.
Bhairava wrenched out of Brahma's fifth head. Brahma howled in agony and begged for mercy.
Oh Lord, I'm not able to bear this pain.
But there was none in Bhairava's shining eyes.
Brahma, you have created this world filled with misery. You are unworthy of reverence. You shall never be worshipped. Few will bother to build temples for you or organize festivals to your glory.